you all for being here. It's an absolute pleasure to be here, and I don't think I can live up to the introduction, so thanks, Jason, very much. So I want to take us on a journey here that we'll probably start with thinking about particularly ministry to young people, and then we'll filter us right into talking about Bonhoeffer. So a few years ago now, it's been a few years, my friend Kenna Creasy Dean and I wrote a book called The Theological Turn in Youth Ministry. The way I describe this book is it's the book with the really pissed off kids on the cover. I don't know why those kids are so angry, but they are. And I think they're mad at you for not buying the book. So you might want to think about that. So we wrote this book because we had this sense, in this larger sensibility, that particularly in America, there was a small group of pastors, but particularly youth workers, that were a little disgruntled. And what they were essentially disgruntled with was this sense that they were expected to kind of be the promoters of church membership, that their job was to create youth programs that would be exciting enough to get disgruntled people, particularly young people, to come and stay at church. And a lot of them, after 3 years, 5 years, 10 years in ministry, started to wonder, is this all this is about? I mean, is this all it's about, is trying to get fickle people to actually commit to staying at church? And they started to ask big questions about God, like, well, where is God in this? And how, in what I do in youth ministry, is this actually connected to God? So we saw a small but a growing number of American youth workers who wanted to actually take a theological turn and ask big questions about God and faith and transcendence, and not just building programs to get young people to think the church was cool. Now, here's the confession of this, is that, at least for me, sometimes it takes standing up in front of a group of people to really know what you are trying to say in a book. And it took a while for us to really get clear about what we were trying to say in this book. I still commend the book to you. You should buy one for your cat, because cats can read. Buy one for your cat, buy one for your grandfather or something. Still commend it to you. But I don't think we were really clear on what we were actually asking people to turn away from and what we were asking them to turn towards. We could have been more specific about that. For instance, though, I think we were pretty specific that we were asking youth workers, and really pastors in general, to turn away from thinking about ministry as a technology, to not think about it as a technology. Now, let me be really clear off the bat that I like technology. If you go to conferences with young pastors, it's amazing that if you insult the Bible, they think you're really hip and on the edge. But if you insult Twitter, they murder you in the hallway. So let me be really clear. I like technology. I actually have an Apple Watch, which means I'm better than all of you. So I like technology. I like it a lot. Actually, when I rank the things that I love in my life, I rank my children, my computer, my wife. Like, those are the things that I love. That's totally insulting. It's not even true. It's my kids, my computer, my TV, my wife. Those are the things that I actually love. I like technology, and technology's great. But here's the thing about technology, is that technology does have a way of setting us up with a certain social imaginary. So I think very few people that we know in our neighborhoods, that are in our classrooms, few people that go to our churches actually have a social theory, but they do have a social imagination on what's the good life and how do they live that good life and how do they understand themselves in the world. And I think one of the things about technology is that it does give us a certain social imaginary. And the social imaginary is, it tends to tell us that everything in the world is a problem and there's some functional solution to solve it. That everything's a problem and there's some functional solution to solve it. Maybe this is just an American confession. It probably is a deeply just American confession. But I think Americans have the kind of social imaginary where they know there are big problems in the world, but they think there's going to be some functional solution to solve them. Like, we know the ice caps are melting in the North Pole, but we think at some point someone's going to create an app to fix it. You know, like, there's going to be some technological solution. Or maybe the greatest example of how this goes from problem to solution and how technology actually can solve amazing problems is, think of that classic movie Apollo 13. You know the movie Apollo 13 with Tom Hanks? And one of the classic scenes of that movie is Tom Hanks takes his crew up, they enter into their lunar orbit, and something goes wrong in the spacecraft, and we get that classic America cinema line where he radios back to Houston down below, and the line is, "Houston, I think we have a problem." And if you remember the film, the next scene is the actor Ed Harris, who's the kind of lead technician down in Houston. He comes into a boardroom. He has a cardboard box. He has all his best technologists and engineers in a room. He dumps over the box and he says, boys, this is all they have up there. It's like the cover of the lunar manual, a screwdriver, some tape, and he says, you got to get them home. And they actually do it. I mean, it's historical reality. These guys get these guys home. I mean, technology can solve amazing issues. But I think it does give us this kind of sense that everything's a problem and there's some technical solution to solve it. Actually, there's a sociologist named Richard Stiver who teaches at the University of Illinois who's written this book called Technology as Magic, where for most of us, we don't know how our phones work, but it has a kind of magical connection that can do things for us. So let me maybe give you a diagram of this. And my wife says you have to be on drugs to understand my diagram. So I guess I'm saying smoke them if you got them. Here we go. So we could think of technology as science used to solve a problem. That it's science used to solve a problem that then creates some kind of new form which should lead to exponential growth or should grow capital. So a good example of this is remember when the iPhone made that switch, I think it was the iPhone 5 to the iPhone 5S, and the new home button came along? And so what happened was Apple knew that they had a problem, and it was a security issue with that home button. So they got their best technologists together, and they came up with a new form for the home button. They put it in the next derivative of the iPhone, and they knew when they would release that iPhone, it would move massive amounts of units, and Apple's stock would go up. Now, I tell you all this because I think what's at least happened in America, and we tend to globalize across the world, is particularly a ministry like youth ministry has become a technology. And what happens is the church realizes we've got a problem. And the problem is our kids don't like going to church, or they're apathetic. So if we could get a new form of ministry, a new form of youth ministry, then it could solve our problem, and they would come to church, and it should bring some kind of growth. We should see more members. We should see a more exciting church. And if it doesn't, then maybe we just have the wrong technologist and the wrong youth pastor, and we need to get somebody cooler and hipper to actually run our program. So when we wrote this book, The Theological Turn in Youth Ministry, I think we were really clear to turn away from thinking about ministry as a technology, as a functional problem. And of course, a big issue with it is it turns our own children into problems to solve instead of people to actually encounter and to encounter God working and moving in their lives. So that was the first thing. We asked people to turn away from it. And I think we were pretty clear about that. It was the second thing that we were not so clear about. And it actually, when we wrote this book, The Theological Turn, it sometimes was assumed to be the theology turn in youth ministry. And this we were less clear about. But I would have people come up to me at conferences and say, hey, thanks so much for writing this book. Because, you know, I've been teaching confirmation at my church, or, you know, I'm a parent really interested in this stuff. And really what I've been just saying for years is if we could just get 11 and 12-year-olds to read Soren Kierkegaard, then everything would be okay. And I didn't know what to say because they just complimented me. So I'd be like, yeah, I think. But I don't think what will help us, and I love systematic theology and I love reading theology, but I don't think it's just about getting theology in the heads of young people. One of my first ministry experiences actually is I was an undergraduate, first year undergraduate, and I was invited to be a confirmation teacher in the Lutheran church that I had grown up in, fairly big church, and they were going to have a confirmation retreat for all of the ninth graders. And they went up on a Friday night to a camp, and for some reason I had a late class or something and couldn't go up with the group. And I was going to drive up with another volunteer leader whose name was Ryan. And Ryan was a first-year seminary student. So he's a first-year graduate theology student. And we got in the car, and Ryan, God bless him, was as annoying as all first-semester, first-year seminary students are. God bless all of them. But he was taking in new information, and he loved it. So we rode up, and he said to me on the ride up, he said, you know, I'm going to give the talk to the ninth graders on Saturday afternoon, and we just have got to be done with this fun and game stuff in youth ministry. What young people need is they need theology, and we've got to give them theology. Now, at the time, I couldn't even spell theology, so that sounded good to me. And so we got at the camp, and we got ready to enter the chaos of the ninth grade retreat, and he looked at me one more time, and he said, get ready. You'll see tomorrow. I'm going to give these kids theology. So sure enough, Saturday afternoon comes by. He stands up in front of about 25 ninth graders, and I guess you could say he gave them theology. It was about 25 minutes of parsed Hebrew verbs, a little bit of a debate on authorship of Pauline epistles, a whole piece on the whole temple system in ancient Israel. This was all going on every minute, and I would watch the young people, and every 5 minutes you could just see his quote-unquote theology just weighing them down. And finally, kind of flustered, he ended his 25 minutes, prayed for the group, and they all stood in unison, like they were a choir or something, and raced out the back door to free themselves from the minutia of his theology. I love theology. I would choose to read only theology, but I'm not sure that just getting theology in kids' heads is what this is actually about or will actually help us form faith in them. I think what we were about, lucky for us, and this is lucky for us, is that the title of the book is actually exactly what we were about. We were about taking a theological turn. And I'm actually leaning on, Mark Taylor has written this book called The Theological and the Political. And one of the things he looks at is he tries to show that theology is often a guild-based discipline. And he thinks, and he's working particularly with the way prisoners are making meaning and thinking about God. And he calls the theological something else. And I think we were drawing on this as well, though we didn't know it or weren't as explicit enough, that the theological starts somewhere different. That the theological actually starts with the lived and concrete experience of young people. It actually starts with their wrestling in their own journey. It starts with their lived and concrete experience. Now, I've done something difficult here, and I'm trying to parse the difference between theology and the theological, so I need to give you an example of this. And I think one of the greatest theological thinkers we've had, who's tried to seek for God in a confession of faith in lived experience, is, of course, Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And that Bonhoeffer still captivates people nearly 100 years later, 110 years later after his birth, because in many ways he's wrestling with who is Jesus Christ for us today. And it continues to be a question we wrestle with. So I want to get in a little bit into my book that Jason referenced, Bonhoeffer as Youth Worker. I had this sense for many years that Bonhoeffer, and if you've read anything about Bonhoeffer, there's this sense that Bonhoeffer did stuff with young people. And so I started to research this book and had this kind of sensibility that I didn't know how far it went, and I didn't know how far this research would take me. Maybe it would just take me to recognize, oh yeah, there's these episodes that people talk about that Bonhoeffer did them. But I became very surprised, actually, that all of Dietrich's adult life, basically from 1925, when Dietrich is 19 years old, until 1939, when the war comes in full force, all the ministry that Bonhoeffer did was either with children or youth. I think it's a fair thing to say that Dietrich Bonhoeffer is a youth worker thinking theologically, or he's a theologian with young people on his mind, and that all the work he does, he's doing really with young people. So let me lay this out for you a little bit, and we're going to go a quick overview of Bonhoeffer's life. And if you get interested in this, you can read Betka's 1,000-page biography tonight to fall asleep. But if we look at this from the very beginning, it's, I think, Bonhoeffer's story is still one of the most fascinating stories in theology. And talk about doing the theological. It's always, Bonhoeffer's theological reflection is often born from his lived experience. So Dietrich's born to these two people named Karl and Paula Bonhoeffer. And there's more to talk about than we have time with these people because they're very interesting. Paula Bonhoeffer is the daughter of a practical theologian. She is, her grandfather is a well-known historian. The Von Hases is their name. And they're church people all the way through. Her father even preached at the Kaiser's court for a while. Karl Bonhoeffer, he has no noble blood in him whatsoever. He's what the Germans would call at this time a middle-class man. He'll be a man of great privilege, but he will make a name for himself. But as a middle-class man who will make his name in the university, yeah, he has little interest in the church, and actually is a good 19th century man, thinks that the church is passé and old, and at best is an agnostic, maybe an atheist. Well, at the time that they're courting in Mary, something has happened around Germany it's very fascinating, and to understand Bonhoeffer as a minister, I think you have to understand this, and particularly as a youth worker, is that all of German society, it starts in the middle class, but it spreads throughout German society, is very concerned for the young people. Because what's happened is a whole German youth movement has occurred, and it's called the Wandervogel. And what essentially happens is middle-class young people feel disconnected from their fathers. They feel like their fathers are too harsh, and they feel like middle-class life in a prosperous Germany is boring too. So they essentially decide that they will gather in groups, usually with an older boy. They'll gather in groups and decide to walk, to wander the hills of the continent and walk around them, singing songs and swimming in lakes. I don't understand it, but it's what they did. And so they would get together in their shorts and they would hike and sing songs. There used to be in the 1970s a Coke commercial in America, like "Can I Buy the World a Coke?" where was really a reflection of the Vondervogel, of all these like hippies walking the streets, strumming and playing their guitars. And it's essentially what happened, that these youth started to ramble. They started to walk the hillside, and it freaked German society out. And they're like, what is wrong with our children? What is going on with them? Why are they doing this? And even one of the kind of leftovers of this cultural reality, at least in part, is the youth hostel. The youth hostel that you can now go to, that during the time of the Vondervogel, parents got really nervous that they would just go and camp out. So they started to create some places where they could actually wander and sleep. And we still have these things. But it all goes back to this German youth movement. If you want to know two very famous Vondervogelers, one was the child psychologist that everyone knows, Erik Erikson, was a Vondervogeler. And he actually renamed himself. He was disconnected from his father, thought his stepfather was a cold, hard man. So he renamed himself Erik Erikson and wandered the hills. And he's a great example because the Vondervogel really was a romantic youth movement. The American youth movement of the 1960s was a revolutionary youth movement. It was trying to create a new society. The German youth movement was a recovery of the medieval poet and scholar. So you went and you tried to recap what it was like to be a medieval poet. And Erikson's a great example because he went to walk the hillsides and paint them and stumbled his way into Vienna and found his way with Anna Freud. And the next thing you know, he becomes a great child psychologist himself. Another Vondervogler is Adolf Hitler, is a Vondervogler. And he gets part of this youth movement. But it's important to understand then from basically the last decade of the 19th century in really until the Nazis take over, youth and the fear of our youth and what's happening with them is all over Germany. And it will only end essentially when the National Socialists do what the National Socialists do, which is take everything inside their own program and build it up and then of course kill it. And the Hitler Youth, I mean, one of the reasons Hitler Youth becomes a Hitler Youth is because it's taking over all the vitality of the German youth movement and bending it towards its own ideological will. So this is big because Dietrich will, one of the reasons Dietrich will really give himself over to young people, and you'll see some connections here, is because this German youth movement is going on. Now, of course, Dietrich's born in 1906. You can't see this picture very well, but there is his brothers and sisters. We don't need to get into this, but he's the sixth of eight children. They're all incredibly talented people. They either are physicists, they are lawyers. The brother-in-laws that will come into the family are incredibly talented people. And Dietrich is one of the younger ones. So he's born the second half. He's the sixth of eight children, sixth or seventh. It depends on how you count it. He's a twin. And I think to understand even the theology of Dietrich Bonhoeffer, you have to understand him as a twin. The social orientation of his theology, I think, is embedded in the fact that he has this sister named Sabine. If you want to reread Life Together, and it will haunt you, because Life Together is written after his twin sister, who he loves dearly, has snuck out of Germany because her husband is a Jew, and had to get up in the morning, put multiple coats on the children, three pairs of socks on them, go to the train station, and with Dietrich's help, get into Switzerland so they could get over to London, and couldn't even tell the children what they were gonna do for fear that they would give them up, and as children may accidentally do. And so Dietrich goes to his sister's house, who now has been gone for days. House is still set up as if they're going to return any minute. And he sits in that empty, haunting house and writes this book, Life Together, while his twin has gone and may never return to Germany again and has thankfully made it to London. But so Dietrich is a twin. He'll have a younger sister named Susanna. But his family life is so significant to Dietrich. And so he's the sixth of eight kids. All the others are talented. But Dietrich would always know himself as one of the young ones. And I think that experience of always being one of the young ones gave him a particular sensitivity to young people themselves. But the big move for Dietrich that's important is in 1918, Dietrich's two oldest siblings, oldest brothers, Karl Friedrich and Walter, go off to World War I into the front. And the Bonhoeffer family had experienced nothing but absolute glory. It had been promotion after promotion for Karl. It had been moving up and up to chair, to bigger house. It had been nothing but success for the Bonhoeffer family. And the oldest boys go off to the front. Paula Bonhoeffer, who was a very dignified aristocratic German woman, the story goes that the train left with those two boys off to the front, and she ran, something a woman of her station should not do, ran after that train, waving to the boys. She had a particularly strong connection to Walter, and Walter went off to the front. Eventually, a letter comes home. He's writing about troop movements as he's dying of his own wounds, and Walter would die. Dietrich would be 12 years old when Walter would die, and it would haunt, in many ways, the rest of his life. His mother would grieve so severely for the loss of Walter, she would have to leave the family for 6 to 8 months and move in with a neighbor. Karl Bonhoeffer had been keeping a journal of the family's successes throughout, didn't keep the journal for years. Essentially escaped to his study, and at least emotionally didn't come out of it for months. And Dietrich is a 12-year-old, haunted by the screaming of his mother and the shut down emotional state of his father. And I think Dietrich becomes this individual who's very aware that small children ask big questions, that small children are haunted by big realities. And he knew this from Walter's experience. Just to show you how deep this must have infused in his consciousness, Dietrich would be given at his confirmation Walter's confirmation Bible, with Walter's name still written in the cover of it. And Dietrich would use that Bible his whole life. Every sermon he preached, you can imagine him writing discipleship or Nachfolge, the cost of discipleship, and reading the Sermon on the Mount again. It's out of Walter's Bible that he reads that. So you have a young man here who's, as he grows, is always sensitive that children have these deep experiences. Well, as Dietrich would go into his own adolescence, and by 1922, his biographer says, Betke says, in a heading, that as he entered into gymnasium, into high school, that Dietrich decided that he would become a theologian. And Betke says he became a theologian to outdupe them all. In other words, Dietrich didn't have an adolescent rebellion by drinking and driving fast. He had his adolescent rebellion by deciding that he will study theology. And he did it in part because no one else in his family had done it. I mean, there was a maternal side of his family who had been interested in church affairs, so was living kind of into the maternal side. But his brothers, the last thing they would do, they, like his father, were agnostics at best, if not atheists, had no time for the church. And so he decided to be a theologian to kind of, as we would say in the United States, give the rest of his family the middle finger a little bit and find a space for himself to do what he wanted to do. His older brothers pulled him aside at one point and said, Dietrich, you are a far, far too talented boy. Do not waste your talents on the church. And Dietrich, with the hubris that Dietrich Bonhoeffer has, I mean, we love Bonhoeffer, but we have to recognize Bonhoeffer said this about himself, that his biggest spiritual problem was his own arrogance. And it starts when he's in high school, in gymnasium, and they say, Dietrich, you are far too talented. Do not waste your talents on the church. Dietrich turned to them and said, well, if the church is backward, then I will reform it. So, I mean, he thinks pretty highly of himself. So Dietrich becomes a theologian and starts studying theology, but there are two men at this point that are really impactful to what will set the terms for the rest of his ministerial life. His two oldest sisters start dating neighbors that eventually they marry. And one is a man by the name of Hans von Dahani, who will actually be the very person that will get Dietrich into the conspiracy to begin with, and who will be working for the Abwehr, or essentially the German CIA. And he's a young man at this time. And the other, his oldest sister, Ursula, marries a man by the name of Rudiger Schleicher, who will be involved in the resistance as well. Both of them will be killed in the resistance, along with Dietrich and his brother, Hans. And both of these men have incredible impact on Dietrich because he is just 15, 16, 17 years old, as there are these young adults who have created a career for themselves. And what they do is they spend a lot of time with Dietrich. And they honor his questions. And they take him to the orchestra. And they ask him political questions. And they assume that this 15 or 16-year-old has something to offer them back. And the rest of Dietrich's ministry with young people, he'll believe this. He'll believe small children are haunted by deep questions that must be honored and embraced. And he'll believe adolescents, that they can wrestle with these big questions. And in many ways, the pattern that Rudy and Hans von Dahani use with with Dietrich, he'll use with young people, taking them to the orchestra, taking them to his parents' cottage, asking them big questions, asking a group of young people to think about what does it mean to be Catholic in a modern world. This is what they would dialogue about this. He has this sense that these young people have something to offer at the intellectual level as well as at the spiritual level. Well, Dietrich goes off to university. He goes to Tübingen because that's where all Bonhoeffer children go. He does well at Tübingen. I don't quite understand this, but he had some ice skating accident. His parents got very concerned that he had this ice skating accident. They came to Tübingen. Maybe they felt guilty about the ice skating accident, but they said, we'll pay for you to go spend a semester in Rome. Go to Rome. Your brother is going to Rome too. Go with him. Study in Rome. Well, in Rome, Dietrich's mesmerized. And he's particularly mesmerized by watching pilgrims go to the Vatican. And he can't stop watching this happen. And he finds his thesis. He wants to write. He wants now to really be a theologian like his father, be an academic, and actually maybe be a lecturer in a university. And he's got his thesis he could write his doctoral dissertation on. And he will write about the social orientation of the church. He will write about what the church actually is, and how it functions for people as a sociological reality in a theological vein. But he also thinks he may want to be a preacher or a pastor as well. So he heads back to Berlin, moves back with his parents, and at 19 years old, starts his doctoral dissertation. He will finish it at 21. If you need to feel bad about yourself, just read Bonhoeffer's biography, because you start to realize, I've done nothing with my life. So Bonhoeffer starts it at 19, and in 1925, like I said, he's still kind of flirting with this idea he might want to be an ordained pastor as well. So at the time he starts writing this, his dissertation, which will become his first book, Sanctorum Communio, he goes to his local judicatory, his local synod, and says, I think I might want to be ordained. And of course, the Bonhoeffer children had never been to church. Karl forbid it. And now, in the irony of all ironies, this young man thinks he's going to write a thesis on a church that he's really never been to. And so the church, his synod and the people who oversee his ordination say, you know, Dietrich, that's great that you may want to be ordained, but you think it'd be a good thing if you went to church once in a while? So they sent him to the local church in his neighborhood in Grenwald, and he showed up. And they did what has happened to a lot of us in this room. You show up and someone sees that you may have some propensities towards ministry, and what do? They send you to the children. And so they sent Dietrich to the children, and he started to do children's ministry. And according to Betke, his primary biographer, he became enamored with children's ministry. And his days were spent either reading deeply in philosophy and sociology and theology to write this dissertation, or preparing children's sermons and children's lessons. And it captivated him, and he loved it. So 1925, Dietrich becomes essentially a youth minister or a children's minister, and spends his time telling these stories and writing these stories, and it absolutely captivated him. One of the really fascinating things is when the doctoral dissertation was done, and then would become the book Sanctorum Communio, not only would the great Karl Barth, call that book a theological miracle. And why he means it's a theological miracle is both because it's a good book, but also because it was written of the faculty of Berlin, in the kind of hub of liberal German theology, and it has this incredible kind of Christological vein to it. So it was this theological miracle. But if you reread it, and most Bonhoeffer scholars have not pulled these pieces out, there's all sorts of elements of children within it. And there's all sorts of elements of family. And one of the things Dietrich is really pushing is that the church can never be, and I think this is quite relevant for us in our Western societies, that the church can never be a volunteer society, but has to understand itself as a life community. And the way to understand the church as this kind of community where persons share in community and are differentiated and honored as distinct persons but bound to others is to think about the church in the same kind of vein as how a family functions. And so he'll then talk about how children are part of a family by both act and being. They are part of it by the act of others to essentially elect them into the family by acting to bring them into the world. But as they are brought into the world, they're brought into the world in and through their being. And he writes about Sunday school a little bit, and he writes particularly about baptism, and says that if we believe in baptism of infants, Dietrich says as a good Lutheran, then we must be these life communities. If we're volunteer societies and we and we baptize infants, we are living a contradiction. And then he has this incredible element that must have also played in this kind of Catholic sensibility as he watched it, where he said the practical form of the church is actually to mother. That the church in its very practical form is to be mother and to carry children. So the primary shape of the church in the world, the mission of the church in the world, is to carry children. So you could think about, as my country struggles with immigration and we get news reports of five-year-olds put in handcuffs, what Bonhoeffer would say to us is if the church is faithful, the church, before it even stands for any other ideological position, it cares for children. And if there are children who are being opposed or put down, we must rise up and speak for them because the practical form of the church is to carry children. It's a beautiful thing, and it rarely comes out in a lot of Bonhoeffer scholarship. So I was at Bart's house this summer, and I'm holding Bart's volume of Sanctorum Communio that he called a theological mirror. Excuse me, I'm very jet-lagged, so I'm going to move past that very quickly. So Bonhoeffer then finishes up his dissertation in 1927, the end of 1927, and at the same time he finishes up his first ministry experience as this children's minister. He starts a youth group there, and this is he takes the kind of form of Rudy and Hans, where he brings them over to his parents' house, and they have discussion groups, and he gives them questions to talk about, really intense philosophical questions, but he honors their intellect. But he finishes up the dissertation in 1927, and it's rewarded highest marks, and he finishes up his ministry in 1927 as well. And but he's got a problem. And the problem, which will make you even feel more insecure, is that he's gone too fast. He's now 21 years old, and at this time to qualify to be ordained, you need to be 25. And really to get a university position, you need to be 25 as well. So he's gone too fast, and he doesn't know what to do. Well, through his ordination process, he's met this man named Max Dressel, who is not an academic, but a good churchman, and is very into the ecumenical movement, and he notices that Dietrich is incredibly talented, and that Dietrich also has this kind of propensity to travel, and Max is very into the global church. And so he encourages Dietrich and feels like it'll be good for Dietrich, this very privileged young man, to get out of Berlin, to stretch his legs and get out of Berlin, get away from his very famous family. So he encourages him to go do a year-long internship at a German-speaking congregation in Barcelona. So Dietrich goes, and it becomes his first full-time ministry experience. What does he do? He does some preaching. He gives them three lectures that are very interesting. One is on Jesus Christ as the creator of childhood, which is a beautiful lecture. One is about ethics, which scholars love to contrast the Bonhoeffer from the written ethics in this early, early sermon, which is quite different, where Dietrich will even talk about there the need to stand up for blood and land, which he loses as the National Socialism comes. But what stays very consistent is his place for children. And he believes that Jesus Christ, he says in this lecture, the only ones Jesus Christ loves more than children are the outcast and the oppressed. But the child is fundamental to Jesus Christ. And he actually, Jesus is the inventor of childhood. It's not a psychological category for Bonhoeffer. It's actually a theological category. Jesus is the one who values and upholds childhood. Gets involved in the Sunday school, reboots the Sunday school, teaches confirmation, becomes a profound experience. I'm going to come back to that to even illustrate a little bit more what I mean by the theological. It ends very well, but Dietrich still has this pull within him. Should he get the lectern of an academic? Should he take the pulpit of a preacher? And he wants to hold these things together. Well, you know, in the German system, you not only have to write one dissertation, but you have to write another one. You write one to qualify as doctor and another one to qualify to actually be a lecturer in the German system. So Dietrich needs to write this second dissertation. He has an advisor that he used for his first one. I'm sure you've heard of the name before, Adolf von Harnack, who was maybe the greatest church historian of the last 200 years. And Dietrich was family friends with him and took the train to the university with Adolf von Harnack most days of the week. And Dietrich actually decided, Harnack begged him to allow Harnack to be his advisor, and Dietrich said no. Because Dietrich was afraid, not because he didn't love Harnack, he loved Harnack, but he was afraid that if he studied under Harnack, he wouldn't be able to think for himself. He would be mesmerized by his brilliance. So Dietrich quite honestly says this, he chose a lesser man who was kind of boring and chose this man by the name of Seberg to be his advisor because he said, I will never be mesmerized by this dud. I mean, he didn't quite say it like that, but that's essentially what he meant. So he does Sanctorum Communio with Seberg, but decides that he'll do what's often called your HABI, your habilitation schrift. He decides that he'll do this with Seberg as well. And he writes Seberg from Barcelona and says, I think I have my thesis. I want to write it on children. I want to write it on the consciousness of children. Philosophical project. Seberg writes back and says, that will not do. Absolutely not. And so Dietrich has to choose a more philosophical topic, and he writes a book called Act and Being, where he both affirms and critiques Martin Heidegger and affirms and critiques Karl Barth in this. Very dense philosophical piece. But if you read it, and good luck if you read it, if you read it, at the very end of it, he smuggles in his original idea. And there's a final section on the child as eschatological, where Dietrich makes the point that the form, the eschatological form, is the child. It's quite a beautiful piece, short piece, but he gets it in there. He qualifies, things have gone well, it's now 1930, but still, he's gone too fast. Now he has HABI in hand, but he still can't become a lecturer. He can be an assistant, but he can't really get a full position, and he's still not ready to be ordained. So Max comes to him and says, go to New York. You went the other side of Europe, this time go to New York City. And so Dietrich in 1930 heads to New York City, and we won't get into this period very much, but it is a profound time for Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And Bethke actually says in this period, the theologian becomes the Christian. And there's a huge reawakening of Dietrich towards some kind of level of pietism. And of course, Lutherans get uneasy with the word pietism. But there's some movement into spiritual practice of reading the biblical text, of prayer, that awakens at this time. And very important friendships are created here that change Dietrich. He meets a man, a French man named Jean Leger, who actually convinces Dietrich that when he reads the Sermon on the Mount, there would be no discipleship, cost discipleship without Jean Leger, who teaches him that when you read the Sermon on the Mount, we should read this as the command of Christ to follow, not just as a Lutheran law gospel hermeneutic, which is to set up what we can't do and that we need God's acts to justify us. This is actually the call of Jesus to follow. He meets another man named Erwin Schutz, who is very significant because Erwin Schutz actually knows Karl Barth. And he will be the connection that will get Dietrich connected personally with Karl Barth. I'll tell you a story later about Paul Lehmann, who is an American German descent, but an American ethicist who's working on his dissertation. Dietrich is studying at Union Seminary, I should have said, and meets him there. But the person that is probably most impactful and most interesting to think about is a man by the name of, in Bonhoeffer scholarship, he's been often called Frank Fisher. We've now learned from the very good research of Reggie Williams, who's written a book called Bonhoeffer's Black Jesus, that his family called him Albert Fisher. And Albert Fisher was an African-American who was studying at Union. And Dietrich had visited all the great pulpits of New York City, Methodist Church, Lutheran Church, Presbyterian Church, and found them all deplorable, found them all to not be preaching the gospel. Where he found real religious vitality, as he says, true spirituality, was when he went into Harlem, into the storefront African-American churches. He found a deep well of spirituality. And so he became a Sunday school teacher working with African-American youth in Harlem. And it became an incredible, significant experience for him. One of the other elements that Dietrich takes away from New York City is he finds the Negro spirituals to be the most beautiful artistic expression of North America. And he takes home a crate of those spirituals. And to talk about the theological, the lived experience, those spirituals would become, besides Walter's Bible in many ways, the core artifact of his ministry. He would sit around with university students, with confirmation students. When he would be leading Finkenwalde at the legal seminary, they would sit around and they would listen to these Negro spirituals of the pathos of these people of oppression and ask, who could Jesus Christ be for us today? How do we confess faith next to this experience? So New York becomes very significant for Dietrich. He heads back home after his year spent there in 1932. And he heads home, and the first thing he does is he puts down his bags, and he gets on a train, and he goes to see Karl Barth. Schutz has made an opportunity for him to do so. He goes and has a very significant experience where Barth is pretty well known for being skeptical, particularly of Berliners who come to visit him. Wonder if it's a trap of German liberal students there to attack him. But Dietrich stands up during one of the seminars and asks a question about Luther. And Bart is also known to be quickly overturned and quickly mesmerized by a student. And he asks this beautiful question. And then Bart sends one of his students to Bonhoeffer, invites Bonhoeffer for dinner. And they both really hit it off. And Bonhoeffer says about Bart, he's actually one of the strange theologians who listens more than he talks. And Bart said about Bonhoeffer, now that is a true German's German. That is a true German's German in every way. That he is the epitome of a German, which will be very interesting as he rises up and gives his life for this nation that you can't deny that he is part of. So he goes there, but he heads home after this time with Bart, and he's got this issue, and the issue is it's now time to be ordained. And also he has been given an opportunity to lecture at the University of Berlin, but he doesn't have the time. He doesn't have the time particularly to write the lectures to be able to give them, and he needs a break. So he goes to Max Dressel and says, could we put off my ordination for a few months so I could write these lectures? And Max is a cunning guy and says, I don't know, Dietrich. We've been waiting a long time to ordain you. But I tell you what, I'm involved in this group, this ecumenical Christian group, this ecumenical movement, and we're having a meeting in Cambridge. And if you come with me to that meeting, I think I can find a way to get you 3 months to write these lectures. So Dietrich goes as a guest to Cambridge for the meeting of the ecumenical movement and leaves it voted in as the secretary to youth in the ecumenical movement. So I don't know what happens there, but this is a guy that just spills forth that he works with young people. Actually, on that first trip to New York City in 1930, Dietrich meets on the boat over a young 12-year-old named Robert Earn, who he stays friends with the rest of his life, writing him letters, sending him Christmas presents, that this is just a man who has a sensitivity towards young people, finds him incredibly interesting. And so he's voted leader of the ecumenical movement. Starts lecturing, starts working at a technical college as the preacher. He's lecturing at the university. And then he gets a call from the synod, and they've got a problem. They've got an out-of-control confirmation class, and they need someone to take it over. Now, I don't know what they were thinking. God bless denominational leaders, but they tend to care more about getting functions done than people being over busy. And this young man was Dietrich was way over busy, but they decide that he's the person for them. And he takes over this out-of-control confirmation class in the wedding district of Berlin, which is a very kind of rough, economically challenged area. And he takes it over, and it becomes a very, very important thing to him. And I'll tell you another story about that later. But he would lead them then all the way through and preach their confirmation sermon. And according at least to Renata Wind, who's written a nice little biography, if you want to read it on Bonhoeffer, called The Spoke in the Wheel, she says on the very day that Bonhoeffer preaches the confirmation sermon on Jacob wrestling with God and pleading with these boys who are in very difficult economic situations, the very boys that will be easily swept up into the Hitler Youth, or will be swept up into a certain form of communism, socialism, and then be crushed by the National Socialists, literally beaten up in the streets. He pleads with them to hold on to God in the midst of the wrestling. According to Wind, that very day, there's a vote, and the National Socialists have won enough seats that they are now players in the political system in Germany. It's very important, especially in my country now, as we really lift up Bonhoeffer in this time. We often think of Bonhoeffer from day one was really involved in political engagement. He really wasn't. Not until 1933 does Bonhoeffer ever really even care about the political. He's too busy doing other things. And he is getting reports, however, from his brothers that say they're starting to flirt with fascism here, or this could be a bad news. They're allowing bullies to take over our country. But he really isn't that involved. Well, 1933, things change. And they change because really Dietrich's closest friend and one of his only few friends of his whole life, a man by the name of Hildebrand, who is also an ordained Christian pastor, Lutheran pastor, has Jewish blood in him. His mother is Jewish. And Hildebrand is going to face persecution. And so Dietrich, through Hildebrand, pushes these pastors to take direct action. And they're all very reluctant to do so. But Hildebrandt and Dietrich's relationship would be rekindled, basically because they had met each other at university, but it would be rekindled because Hildebrandt wanted to write a new catechism to use with youth. And he went to the best youth worker he knew of, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and they rewrote a catechism to use with youth, and you can find it in the Bonhoeffer works, where it becomes, talk about the theological again, it becomes about young people's questions that lead into really wrestling with the depth of the Christian tradition. So Dietrich gets involved in 1933, and there's so much more to say there, but what you really need to know is he becomes tired. He tries to push these old school, older pastors to really take action, and they don't want to. And in many of them, it's hard for us to get our heads around now, but for many of them, they thought, listen, Hitler and National Socialism, not good for the church, he's overstepping his bounds, but good for Germany. This could be good for Germany, but maybe not for the church. And so Hildebrandt and Dietrich that were calling for direct action, and Dietrich had started to learn some of the nascent civil rights movement stuff that would be used in the 1960s in the States, and had been very interested in Gandhi, wanted to actually do some non-violent resistance. And he said, we're a state church. Why don't we say to the government, we will not marry or bury anyone until you take us seriously. The other pastor said that's far too radical of a move and refused to do it. And so Dietrich got quite tired, quite exhausted. And in 1935, he departed from Germany and went to London to take over a German-speaking church in London and become the pastor. Karl Barth was very frustrated with him and told him to get his butt on the next boat home. But Dietrich thinks for himself, and Dietrich said, no, I'm staying here. Well, it becomes serendipitous because Dietrich starts taking on certain monastic practices. He, again, is involved in youth ministry a little bit, having young people over to his house, thinking about what kind of political action, resting, also meeting a man by the name of George Bell, who will become a significant person for him in the conspiracy, Bishop Bell, the Bishop of Chester. He'll get to know him at this time. But during that period, we're not sure when it is, there's a little writing that you can find in one of the Bonhoeffer works where Dietrich writes his 8 theses on youth work. And they're really quite fascinating. If we had time, we could go into them. To me, they're incredibly prophetic, at least to American youth ministry, about how the youthfulness will never save the church, only Jesus Christ will save the church. The need to be relevant or vital will never get us to where we want to go. It is only Jesus Christ and the church community filled with the Spirit that will move us anywhere. I mean, incredible 8 theses, and they've often been like a unicorn, where we've heard that Bonhoeffer has written these things, but it hasn't been until everything has been translated that we found them, and we're not sure when they were written, something probably during the time of London. Well, we can round this out really quickly, but you know, Bonhoeffer ends up in Finkenwald, and that becomes quite a significant period. And again, here's a period where he's now principal of an illegal seminary, but youth find their way in again. And they're one of the main, Ruth is her name, she's one of the main financial supporters of this confessing church now, and she's giving money to keep this illegal seminary going. And every Sunday she brings her grandchildren to the school, and Dietrich celebrates them, plays ping pong with them. And in many ways, Finkenwalde is the bringing together of monastic practices in youth ministry. The youth ministry he did with a confirmation class and wedding and these monastic practices. The Nazis, for the most part, it was an illegal, but they didn't care. They had other things to worry about. So it was allowed to kind of exist under the shadow of the National Socialists until they made a mistake. And the mistake they made is that every night they would stay up late, drinking wine, listening to the spirituals, playing the piano, talking about politics, talking about scripture. And they would often hear Dietrich tell stories, because that's what Dietrich was great at. And he would tell stories about his travels. Travels to London, travels to New York City. And in New York City, he was down in Mexico and in Cuba. He went all these places. They heard his travels. Well, Dietrich now here in 1935 and into 1936 is going to be 30 years old. I mean, again, you think, I've done nothing with my life. He's going to be 30. And so the students suggest, you know what we should do? We should travel as a class for your 30th birthday party. We should go somewhere. Get out of Germany. Let's go to Sweden. So they decide to go to Sweden as a class. They get to the docks of Sweden, take a boat over. They get to the docks, and guess who shows up to welcome them? The bishop of the Swedish church. Well, a legal seminary, the bishop of the church there to welcome them. This becomes front page news story. Gets back, of course, to Germany, and within a matter of months, the seminary is closed, and things shift for Dietrich. He continues to do confirmation with Ruth's kids, but of course now in 1939, all formal ministry for Dietrich ends, and therefore his youth ministry ends in 1939. By the time the war breaks out at the end of 1939, Dietrich has a way out. And so he has, Reinhold Niebuhr is actually in the UK. Reinhold Niebuhr is there doing the Gifford lectures. And he gets there and he talks with Niebuhr, and Niebuhr says, I think I can get you to America. I think what we can do is we can have you teach summer session, and we'll have Paul Lehman, who's now living in the Midwest, we'll have Paul Lehman set up a lecture tour. And through that year, you'll make enough connections that you can get a university or a seminary position in America, and you'll survive the war. And Dietrich does it. Gets on a boat, sails in 1939 to New York Harbor, and it's over. He's survived the war. Except as soon as he lands in New York, he has a pit in his stomach that he is not supposed to be there, that he is not meant to be here. He spends about 2 weeks there regretting that he ever came, looking at his watch and thinking about his former students, his brothers, as he calls them. Are they in daily prayer now? What are they thinking? What's happening to the ones that have been taken into the front, into the war machine? What should I do? If you go to Union Seminary, which overlooks Columbia University, you can still go up to a room that's called the Prophet's Chamber, and that was used to be housing, kind of short-term housing, and Dietrich stayed in the Prophet's Chamber. It's now like a little boardroom. And you can go up there, and when Dietrich finally left and they cleaned it out, they found tons of little scribbled notes that were all crumpled up in just loads and loads of cigarettes that he spent most of the time pacing, praying, thinking, smoking. What should we do? What should I do? What should I do? Finally, he decides he's got to return. He writes Niebuhr and says, I'm sorry, Professor, but I cannot sit this out. If I do not suffer this with my people, I'll have no right to be involved in the rebuilding of Germany. And he says to them, my people have a terrible either or. They can either hope and will for the victory of their nation and therefore the end of Christianity on the continent, or they can wish for the defeat of their nation and the continuation of Christianity. I cannot sit this out. I must go home. And so he goes home a changed man. He goes home, and Hans gets him into the conspiracy, and so he participates as double agent spy, his ecumenical connections, getting secrets to the Allies through Bishop Bell. He's finally arrested in 1943. He's arrested on suspicion, which is all you need, that he has been involved in an operation called Operation 7, smuggling 7 Jews out of Germany. He's very confident that this will all blow over soon, and there's a conspiracy, there's a coup d'etat in place to take Hitler out. He thinks that this will happen. Of course, it fails, and Dietrich is soon found out, and by 1945, he's killed. Taken from the Togel prison, he's taken to the SS basement, beaten, put on a truck that is being run not by petrol but by wood, a wood-burning pickup truck, taken to the Bavarian forest, to the concentration camp of Flossenbürg, and killed there. His family would not know he was dead until they heard the service that Bishop Bell did for him from the Westminster Abbey on the BBC radio. They had no idea. The chaos post-war was so huge. Still in this period, Dietrich has his mind on young people. Christopher, Hans von Dahany's son, Christopher, he spends a great deal of time with him. And the first essay Dietrich writes from prison is a really beautiful essay called What Does It Mean to Tell the Truth? And he's writing, and talk about the theological again, a born from lived experience. Here he is being interrogated every day, and he has to lie to his interrogator's face to keep Hans alive, who Hans has been arrested at the same time. Make sure he doesn't say anything to Hans, but he'll then go back to his prison cell and write out and have to think, what does it mean to tell the truth? What does God call for us? And so he starts this essay, What Does It Mean to Tell the Truth? How does he start it? Starts it with young people. What does it mean to tell the truth? What we tell young people, telling the truth isn't just giving pure data. Parents who love their kids, and their kids say, where do babies come from? You don't just say, well, what happens is, you know, dad has a little bit to drink, and then, you know, they're feeling good, and then, you know, the way you tell the truth is based on the context of the persons who stand before you. So truth is always based in the encounter of persons. And then he tells a beautiful parable about a young boy, a young primary school child, And he says, the primary school child, everyone knows it in the village that his father is the town drunk. He comes into school one day, and the teacher, for some reason, decides that he's going to tear this boy down. So he says to the boy in front of the whole class to embarrass him, your father is the town drunk, isn't he? And the boy stands, looks proud, and says, no, my father is not, and sits down. And Dietrich says, what's happened? Everyone knows the boy has lied. We all know. We've seen him stumble around the streets. He says, no, no, no. The boy has told the truth. He has bound himself to his father as a person. What's happened here is as the teacher has asked an untruthful question and put the boy on the spot. So again, thinking these big thoughts through the place of children and families, of what it means to be a child, from the very beginning when he's 19 all the way to his end, it's always a theologian with children on his mind or a youth worker who's trying to think deep theological thoughts. So this takes us all the way back to this thinking theologically perspective and trying to contrast what this means between what is theology and then the theological, and how the theological, I think, is often born from the practice of ministry. So I want to take you back to Barcelona in one of the most beautiful stories of Dietrich Bonhoeffer that we have. And it actually comes from a letter that he wrote to his friend, Walter Dress, who will eventually marry his youngest sister, Susanna. And Walter Dress, like I told you, Dietrich didn't have many people to talk about faith and ministry with. He, you know, his brothers weren't interested. They didn't care. So he meets Walter Dress, and he writes to him about his experience here on his internship in ministry. So he writes in this letter, and the fascinating thing about the letter is that we don't have this letter, we don't discover this letter until 1999, when Walter Dress dies, and they go through a cache of letters and find a letter from Dietrich Bonhoeffer. So it's really quite fascinating and interesting. So this is what happens in this letter. Dietrich writes Walter Dress, and the first thing he says to him is, hey, did I talk to you about Emil Brunner's new book, The Divine Imperative? Emil Brunner is probably, I think you would say, second most important continental theologian at this time, behind Karl Barth. Very important Swiss Reformed theologian. And he has just written a book on ethics. Dietrich, since his own gymnasium days, has been interested in ethics, was awaiting this text. And he says to Walter, did you read it? He says, well, I did. And I am so disappointed. Oh, it was awful. I mean, Brunner should be ashamed of himself. I had to quit 90 pages before the end. Oh, Brunner, how could you do this? This was such a mistake. Here is, again, I mean, we're talking about a 21-year-old kid whose ink on his dissertation is still wet, rips apart one of the greatest theologians on the continent at the time. But then the whole letter shifts. And it's as if, I'm sure this is what happened, that Dietrich thinks of a ministry situation that happened. And so he turns the whole letter around. He says, wait, did I tell you what happened to me? He says, the other day, there are these people in my congregation, and I asked them if I could borrow something. So they sent their 10-year-old boy over to my flat at about 11 a.m. And I know this boy. I know this boy very well. I mean, he's in my Sunday school class, and this boy is the personification of upbeat and crazy. That's who this boy is. Well, he came into my flat, and I noticed that he was down, that he was really quite sullen. And so Dietrich tells Walter Dress that he just attunes himself to the boy. He's just aware of the boy's humanity. And he says, as the boy drops this off, Dietrich finally says to him, are you okay? And as he says that, the tears just drop. And the boy starts sobbing and sobbing and sobbing, this deep, deep sigh. So Dietrich picks him up. I mean, this is the 1920s. And he puts him on his knee, and he just holds him. And the boy sobs and sobs and sobs. And that's the point. It's all it's about. Nothing more. He ministers to the boy. He shares his place. He's with him and for him, as Jesus Christ is with and for us. Dietrich isn't thinking, hey, now the boy's weak. It's time to get the confirmation lesson in his head. He isn't thinking anything like that. He's just with the boy. That's the point. Except Dietrich tells Walter that all of a sudden, in the midst of the tears, he starts to make out words. And he can hear the boy and all the sobbing and all the snot. He can hear, Mr. Wolf is dead. Mr. Wolf is dead. And Dietrich says to Walter Dress, and who is Mr. Wolf? Ah, Mr. Wolf is a 3-year-old German shepherd dog that the boy tells Dietrich had just hours earlier died. And again, Dietrich just holds the boy and gives the boy the space in the context of ministry to narrate his experience. So the boy shares how much he loved this dog, how this dog woke him up every morning. When he came home from school, the dog was the one who was there. That his dog, he loved the dog and he played with the dog, how important this dog was to him. And Dietrich just sits with the boy, just shares in the depth of his lived experience. Reminds me of one of my first youth ministry experience where I was actually the paid youth worker. And I was working for an organization and our whole job was to do evangelism and particularly work at high schools and get kids who had never heard the gospel story to actually come to these very nice camps, be really respected and treated well, and then they would hear the gospel story. And you were supposed to, if you were a good youth worker, you were supposed to fill your camp spots. First of all, they were like gold to have these camp spots, so you had to fill them. And then you were supposed to fill them with kids who had never heard the gospel before. Well, the truth of the matter is that your job really depended on filling those spots. So if you got to the end of the camp time and hadn't filled your spots, you'd just go to a local church and get kids to go so you'd fill your spots. Well, this is my first year at this, and I'd actually done it. I had filled my spots, and with all kids who hadn't heard the gospel before. And I thought to myself, ministry, this is easy stuff, man. Like, this is freaking easy. So I got on the bus, and we headed up there, and one of the kids on the bus was this kid named Adam, and Adam was going into ninth grade. And he was about 6'3", and he played ice hockey as a ninth grader, which where I live, to play ice hockey as a ninth grader means that you are a good athlete, but you are also tough. And he was tough. He was tough and mean. He spit nails. And he would take his stick and cross-check you in the teeth if he needed to. That's who he was. Never been to church a day in his life, but I had got him to go to camp. So again, I'm thinking, this is easy stuff. Well, we get up there, and we're just there a few hours, and they have this thing called the club, which all the kids from the camp gather. There's some music, there's some skits, there's some fun, but then the speaker comes out and starts sharing the gospel story. And just starts sharing the gospel story, it'll be told over four nights. And so he gets up, the speaker does, to start sharing the gospel story, and I look and I see Adam, and he's crying. I mean, this is like 5 minutes into the speaker, and Adam is crying. So I think what any youth worker thinks, I think, we've got him. We've got him. So I'm new in ministry, but I'm wise enough to wait till the whole room clears out and everyone leaves. And now Adam's sitting in the corner, leaning against the wall with his hands on his head, trying to show that he's not crying. So I walk over to him and I say, Adam, you want to go for a walk? And like this boy, he says, yeah. And we're walking and I say, what's wrong, Adam? And then just like this boy, the tears just come and he's bawling. And he starts saying, it's just, and I know what it just is. It's just Jesus. That's what it is, right? That's all it is. And he's like, it's just. And I'm like, yeah, it's just. And now I'm thinking to myself, like, what chapter will it be in? Because clearly this night will save and change his life. And he'll become a really famous missionary, and he'll write his biography. Will I be in the first three chapters of the book or the end of it? Like, where will the chapter on me be? Like, that's what I'm thinking here. And he says, it's just. And I'm like, yeah, man, it's just. And he says, it's just. I'm like, yeah, it's just Jesus. It's just. He says, it's just she doesn't even know I exist. And I luckily didn't say it. I bit my lip, but I got to confess to you, I thought, you stupid kid. Here we are talking about eternity and God, and you care about this girl. You're not going to remember her name in 3 years. What are you doing? And I was just horrified. But at worst, it became an existential crisis because it was like a movie, and I had flashbacks to wait. Oh, yeah, that's right. He was on the bus, and he was flirting with her. Wait a minute. 2 months ago, he told me he had a crush on her since, like, grade seven. Wait. She signed up to go to camp before he ever signed up. He didn't sign up to go to camp because he thought I'm a cool youth worker. He signed up because he was going to make his move. He got to camp. He's like, screw this. I'm not waiting until day two. I'm going to make my big move now. He went right before camp and asked her out. She rejected him before going in. He didn't hear a word the speaker said because he was crying in the corner because he felt rejected. Now, I don't have to tell you people, but pretty bad ministry that night. I mean, if I can't find a way to proclaim the gospel or minister to him through this really deep lived experience of rejection, then where is the gospel? And Dietrich does better than me. So Dietrich just listens to the boy narrate his experience. But this is what's profound, and this is what the theological is that eventually the boy wipes the tears from his eyes, turns to Dietrich with a deep look and says, now you tell me now, Herr Bonhoeffer, will I see Mr. Wolf again in heaven? Will I see him again? And Dietrich writes Walter Dress and says, I had no idea what to say. No idea. Essentially, he says, the PhD seminar on dead dogs, I didn't take that class. I had no idea what to say. And then in even a more profound way, he says to Walter Dress, he says, next to his question, I felt small. I felt small next to his question. Now remember who said that. I've told you, this is an arrogant young man. This is a young man in the first paragraph of this very letter rips Emil Brunner apart. When it is just formal theology, rips him apart. But when the theological bears itself like an eventful revelation, when a broken 11-year-old boy says, where is my dead dog? The arrogant theologian is now on holy ground and he feels small. He feels small next to it. There's a way that ministry is in this incredible holy task. Then the theological is born out of ministry itself. So as he ministers to the humanity of the boy, here comes the theological. That ministry actually bursts these deep theological questions. And he comes. And so Dietrich tells Walter Dress he had no idea what to say. So he wrestled with it. And he says to Walter Dress, he said, unfortunately, the boy wanted a yes or no answer. In other words, I don't know if you had this happen in Australia, but there's generations of pastors in America who are told the way you do pastoral care is to do active listening. So if someone comes and says, I'm really sad because my mother is sick, your move is to say, as a pastoral care person, is to say, I hear you saying you are really sad because your mother is sick. And what Dietrich was saying was that was not going to fly here. Which, if you've been in ministry long enough, you know that's true. When people ask the question born out of this deep experience and out of this experience of actually feeling some being at some kind of holy place of being ministered to, these big questions come and they want an answer. And this boy, this 10-year-old boy looks at him and says, you tell me now, will I see Mr. Wolf again in heaven? And he tells Walter Dress, I didn't know what to say. So he wrestles with it. And Dietrich finally says to the boy, well, we know that God is love. And we know that God loves you. And God surely loves all animals too. Oh, and you loved Mr. Wolf. So yes, I think you'll see Mr. Wolf again in heaven, because I don't believe God loses anything that God loves. So for Dietrich Bonhoeffer, all dogs do go to heaven. Just good news for those of us who love dogs. But this is what I mean by the theological. It's born from the depth of the experience of ministry itself. Now, the way the letter ends is even more profound, because Dietrich tells Walter Dress that, first of all, he was surprised that this was good news to the boy. I mean, in many ways, he thought, I was just making stuff up. I mean, I was just doing constructive theology on the go here. I was just trying to put this stuff together, but the boy saw this as good news. But then he says the boy turned to him, saw it as good news, and said, you know what? I scolded Adam and Eve today because they ate that fruit. And starts talking about what he had learned in his Sunday school class and what he learned in his religion class at school and what he had heard a pastor preach in a sermon. Essentially, what the boy starts doing is the theological himself. He starts thinking theologically. But the boy doesn't need an academic theologian to think theologically. He needs a minister. He needs someone to stand beside him and seek for God and seek for God in a significant way in these deep questions. And that's not to undercut the tradition. And if we had more time, I'd tell you this confirmation story where Dietrich says, I don't prepare for my confirmation class. I simply go and listen to the boy's story. And then he says, well, I'm Dietrich Bonhoeffer, so I know the tradition really well. But what I do is I weave the biblical text into their stories. And so he's not lessening the tradition. He's saying what the tradition does, the tradition lives next to these experiences. And so we need to bring them to bear actually on these lived stories and these lived experiences. I think maybe a way to close it is to tell the story of my favorite biblical text that I think illustrates this and maybe brings us all together. My favorite New Testament story, my favorite gospel story is Mark 9. And you know the story of Mark 9. You have a boy and things have gone quite poorly for this boy. And you have a father who is at his end. He has tried everything to get this boy okay. And the boy now is trying to hurt himself. And we don't know the complete backstory, but it doesn't take much imagination to imagine that this father has been to every specialist he can to try to get this boy right, every healer, and it's not working. And maybe now the boy's not allowed in any classroom. No kid in the neighborhood will play with this boy. And just last week, he hurt his sister. And now there's tension between the man and his wife on what to do with this boy. But the father, again, just to play with this text a little bit, the father gets word that there's a healer named Jesus from Nazareth. And so this is his last chance. So he throws his boy on a horse or on a donkey and he starts walking. And every step he thinks to himself, this time it's going to work. This time, it's got to work. The darkness is overtaking my boy, and if this one doesn't work, I will lose my boy. And he walks to the scene where Jesus is supposed to be, the place where Jesus is supposed to be. He walks into his disciples, and he says, I'm here to see Jesus. The disciples look at him and say, it's too bad, I'm sorry, but Jesus isn't here. Jesus is actually on vacation. He's on holiday. And he is. Jesus is taking his three best buddies, Peter, James, and John. They've grabbed some beers and some hot dogs, and they've headed up to have a mountain getaway bromance together. And they've headed up there, and they're having a great time. I mean, it is a really great time. The hot dogs are cooking on the fire, and things are great, except then it starts getting weird because this fog falls onto the mountains, and then it becomes like the movie Sixth Sense, and they start seeing dead people, and there's Moses, and there's Elijah, and then Peter, who is the disciple with a mouth shaped like a foot, says, teacher, this is an amazing experience. Shall I build a shelter, one for you, one for Elijah, and one for Moses? And the Markan text actually says he did not know what he was saying, which I think the translation is super dumbass thing to say. So he says this stupid thing. We get this word from heaven. This is my son. Listen to him. And bam, it's over. And they're just there holding like the sticks they were making s'mores with, and a half-empty can of beer. They're like, that was incredibly trippy. Well, back down below, the father's been told that Jesus is on vacation. Jesus isn't here. What's he supposed to do? Again, maybe he's walked for days. So he turns to the disciples and said, well, you've been with Jesus. Do something. Do something for my boy. And so they try. It doesn't work. You know, there's nothing more despairing than to have worked yourself up to hope again, to then find that hope crash into a million pieces against the rocks of impossibility. That's exactly what happens. And the father is broken, and chaos is everywhere. And just then, Jesus walks back into the scene. And Jesus walks into the scene and has some harsh words to say to the disciples. But then something absolutely profound happens. Jesus turns to the father, and he says these words. How long? How long has your boy been like this? We miss it because we are Western people living after a scientific medical revolution, and we think that's a diagnostic question. Like, you go to a doctor and says, how long has your elbow felt that way? How long have you had the rash? How long has it been since your computer actually booted up? How long has it been? This is not a diagnostic question. This is the question of the invitation for this man to narrate his experience, to bear his broken humanity. And it becomes a location of ministry. And so the father tells the story. Long enough for it to be destroying me. Long enough for me not to know if I breathe. Long enough to know that if I leave this scene and he is not better, I will die. Long enough to have beat me to the ground. But then somewhere in the midst of narrating that experience and giving his humanity back by the question, how long, he finds it enough to say, and to say it in a way that he dare even not say it because he has hoped and found it impossible so many times. But he says, but teacher, if you are able. And Jesus stops him and says, if I am able, I was just up on a mountain with Moses and Elijah. If I am able, all things are possible for those who believe. And then we get the deep proclamation of New Testament faith where the Father says, I believe. Help my unbelief. It's this incredible moment where maybe what ministry is, what it means actually to do the theological, is to be close enough to people, to bear their humanity enough, to be close enough to say, how long? How long have you felt that way? How long have you felt like you have no friends? How long have you felt like you're unlovable? How long have you felt like the world is so cruel? How long? And in the articulation of that moment, there's this reality of co-humanity that I think witnesses to this deep incarnational reality that Jesus Christ is always found at dead places of how long, bringing new life out of death. And maybe that's what we're called to. And that's what our young people and our old people and all those in between need, is to find somebody who will minister to them and wrestle with these big, deep questions. Let me pray for us. God, thank you for these people. Thank you that they made their way here on a summer night to think about the thought of Bonhoeffer, to wonder about questions of ministry, and to do all this in faithfulness to you, God. So would you bless them, and bless them with the reminder that in their own ministries that you are well pleased, that in the trials and the tribulations and the failings and in the joys, that you are God and that you are pleased. Amen. All right, so I have made the big mistake of when you start talking about Bonhoeffer, you can go on forever. So we are at 9 o'clock. So I'm looking at you because I want you to tell me if this is appropriate or not. But I'm willing, if you have questions, to engage you a little bit. I know people have childcare issues, and there's students here who we've been together for 12 hours in some sense who want to leave. So please feel free to go. But is it okay if we take five to 7 minutes? Is that okay?
Yeah, okay. People need to leave. Then.
Yes, just please leave. I'll just assume you're really offended, and that would be fine. Yes, please.
I'll ask you, what do you think is Bonhoeffer's understanding of being filled with the Spirit?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think if there's a critique of Bonhoeffer that has to be there, is that Bonhoeffer really was mainly working the second article. In other words, he was really more Christological than anything else. So everything, and I think he gets this in many ways from Luther and in many ways from the early Bart, that he's going to think this all through the person of Jesus Christ. But I think what Bonhoeffer would mean if you were to ask him, and if he were to live long enough to write on the Spirit, which the Spirit is there, but it's everything comes back to Christ, to Jesus Christ. It's very Lutheran in that sense. It's very early Bart. And it is fascinating that when Dietrich is writing Sanctorum Communio, he's getting some of Bart's very first lectures from his cousin, Christopher, who's writing them by hand and mailing them immediately to his cousin. But if you were to ask him what Dietrich would say being filled with the Spirit is he would go back to his core theological concept, where he believes that the fullness of the very being of God operates on this German word called Stellvertretung, which means something like place sharing, this union of place sharing. So I think what he would think it actually means to be filled with the Spirit is to be sent in to be your neighbor's Stellvertreter, to share their place, to be your neighbor's minister. And that being filled with the Spirit is actually to be sent to bear your neighbor's hunger, homelessness, and imprisonment. And that is the work of the Spirit that sends us to see the humanity of the other as Jesus Christ before us. So I think he would echo something like Matthew 25, Lord, Lord, when did we see you? That the work of the Spirit is to take us in there. Bonhoeffer's an early 20th century theologian, and late 20th century theology is trying to take a pneumatological turn because they think that these guys didn't do well enough in that. And I think that's true with Bonhoeffer. But I think if he was here today, he would answer it something like that. Yeah. Good. Anything else? I've just beat you into submission. Yeah. Very, yeah.
The eight theses.
Yeah.
Have you memorized them? Can you list them all out?
I could just say stuff and you would probably think, oh, wow, he's really got them memorized, and then go read them and be like, that's not what he said. Yeah, so the eight theses are very interesting. And like I said, we don't know where he gave them. Some people actually think it's possible he did do a kind of presentation at the YMCA in London, and they wonder if this was his YMCA talk. And if it was, I think he would have got booed off the stage, because the last assertion that I actually don't agree with Dietrich on at all is he makes an assertion that any kind of extra ecclesial organization, so like the YMCA or like what we would call in the States a parachurch ministry, where he basically dismantles it and says that's not a true confession of the church. The only place ministry happens is within the Sanctorum Communio, within the ecclesial structure. So he may have got booed off. I find the actual first few to be really interesting. And one of the things that I've been trying to work with in my own work and to maybe push you to take a look at it is Dietrich really thinks what's happened, and one of the things I forgot to tell you, is the only radio address Dietrich ever gave, the title of it was The Younger Generation's Conception of the Führer. And what's fascinating about that radio address is when he was going to get to his main point, it was cut off and the air went dead. And to this day, we don't know why. It's very easy to say, Goebbels, man, cuts it, it's censorship. And that's very possible that it was. We also just don't know if it was technical difficulties. But regardless, it was cut off. It was then reprinted. Dietrich's father pulled some strings to get it reprinted in publications so people could read the end of it. But what Dietrich is doing in that is partly echoing the eight theses. Is he's saying German society has taken advantage of young people. And the von der Vogel and the youth movements have made young people particularly susceptible to a strong leader. And this government, while he's not quite saying it directly, as he's kind of worried about that, this government is taking advantage of young people's susceptibility to a strong leader and using that. So one of the things Dietrich is really pushing against in his von der Vogel youth movement is that Germany, and I think you could say now in our time, America, has been obsessed with youthfulness. Not necessarily the humanity of young people and their big questions, but this sense of what is youthful. And because youthful, and now I'm going to try to kind of construct my own perspective from this, because youthfulness tends to be a primary almost spirit or sensation of authenticity. So in our kind of consumer culture, the authentic one is the youthful one. So now you have everyone who's trying to be, what, 21? Or there's a store in the States, it's like called 21 Forever or something, where it doesn't matter if you're 48 or you're 11, everyone's trying to kind of be like 21. And the American church is notorious for this. You talk to people ask me all the time to speak to them about how they can get young people into the church. And the more you talk about it, it's not that they have a deep yearning heart for young people being in the church. They're actually quite annoyed by young people. But they know that there's no vitality for an institution if it's not attracting the youthful. And it's why every show in America, with a demographic they want, 18 to 35-year-olds. If you can't get the 18 to 35-year-old, it's not a good product, it's not a good television show, and it's not because the 18 to 35-year-old has the most dispendable income. They don't. If you want just dispendable income, go to 65-year-olds. It's because 18 to 35-year-old means cool, means youthful, and cool sells. So whether you're a political party or whether you're a product, whatever it is, you want to have the sense of youthfulness. And churches that feel like they are in a market loss in a secular age feel like if we can reboot ourselves as being youthful, then we'll be okay. And Bonhoeffer, done differently but in a similar way in Germany at this time, he's saying that's idolatry, absolute idolatry. Your churches will never be saved by finding strategies to get youthfulness in them. The only thing that will save the church is Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. So it's a very almost kind of barman assertion in the way of turning back to Jesus Christ as the only one who can save us. And there's other really interesting pieces on that. But the youthfulness thing, to me, is something to really consider. Because I think we look at young people disaffiliating from the church across the Western world, and we think, well, how can we turn that around and get them to affiliate to the church? But why do we want them back there? Because we want their dead dog stories. Because we need it theologically to wrestle with what it means to confess the faith here. Or is it because we want to feel like our institutions have some kind of authenticity that makes them feel somewhat vital? And I think Dietrich would say, that actually is to bastardize what the incarnation is, and to lose the sense of the humanity of young people. That's a start. They're really worth reading. Yeah.
So you're talking about how Bonhoeffer doesn't think that youthfulness can kind of save the church, but you also referenced how, as a young man, he wanted to revolutionize the church.
Yeah.
What was his plan to revolutionize the church, which, you know, sort of presumably the people of older generations, if it wasn't to youthful?
Yeah, I think if you would have asked Dietrich when he said that at 16, he would have... say after New York City critiqued himself for that.
Yeah, okay. Do you think he still wanted to revolutionize the church in that way later when he thought there was no longer youthfulness that we do?
I think if Dietrich would have lived long enough, it would have been interesting to see what would happen. I tend to think if Dietrich would have lived long enough, we always say, you know, like my students will say, oh, I wish I could have taken a class from Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And my response always is, no, you don't. You would have been so mad at him. He would have ripped your papers to shreds and had no time for you. But what would he have done? So, I mean, I say that only because it's hard to assume what would have happened. But I do think that there's something here about Dietrich thinking that what the church does is it carries children. And I think the kind of reform he would have been looking for the church to be is to be communities of persons. Because communities of persons for him. Remember, Sanctorum Communio, the thesis of Sanctorum Communio is Jesus Christ exists as church community. So he's really dealing with something he finds very difficult late 19th century into the 20th century is how do you concretely locate the presence of Jesus Christ? Can you anymore? And he actually thinks that you can concretely say Jesus Christ is here in the midst of a community of persons who confess it, who hear the word, who take the sacraments, who actually share in each other's lives. Who a community built again on this thing called Stellvertretung that actually Bonhoeffer scholars will translate in English vicarious representative action, which is the most unsexy thing I've ever heard. Or sometimes in the older literature, it's called deputyship. But what it really means is this kind of sense of sharing another's place. And what Dietrich would say is what's so fundamentally fascinating about children, and this is what he works out in Act and Being, is that children are different than you. They're differentiated from you, but they're also bound through a relationship. And so what he actually thinks humanity is that humanity is at, we see humanity less obscured, especially in the Western world, when we look at children than we look at adults. We see those who have act and being, who live out of act and being, that they have free act, but they also have their being in a community. So I think one of the critiques of Bonhoeffer, as well as one of the things that's really generative, is that he keeps thinking about what it means to be human, what it means to encounter the living Christ, and what it means to be church, always at least illustratively through what it means to be a child in a family. And I think that's hard for some people, especially in some kind of more kind of liberal bent away from certain forms of essentialism, to be like, well, why would you essentialize certain forms of family as essential, and now you impose ideological perspectives on what it means to be human, and you know it allows certain privileged states to do that. And Dietrich would probably have to affirm that now, but also I think Dietrich wouldn't want to lose that there's something really significant about the attachment and yet the mysterious otherness of a child to their caregiver, that the child is unique in that way. So one of the things that Dietrich says in Sanctorum Communio is he talks about all communities have to be built on free will. And what he means by free will is not like, well, free will to do whatever you want, but that the community is built as will. Everyone in the community must have the freedom to will themselves within it. But then he says, well, we got a problem, because we have infant baptism, which it appears that little babies don't get to will whether or not they want to be baptized. So what do we do? But Dietrich says, well, that's to be captured by a certain form of individualism. Actually, babies, even infants that are a few days, do will. Ask a mother who's nursing a baby. There's a distinctive will here. So when the parents will for their child to be baptized, they actually take the will of the child into the community. And there becomes this reality of collective person. And so that's a big concept that Dietrich's working that's really hard for us to think about, but it's quite profound, is that Dietrich would just not believe, particularly in this American sense, that you are a cut-off free individual, cut off from all else. So no, what the church is a collective person. And we form these collective persons, and there is the freedom that we all will within them, but we also then become a collective. And even infants become willing agents within the collective person, because they become collective person with their parents, and their parents bring that will in. So Dietrich would actually say ministering to parents of newborn babies is a huge ministerial task, because there's big existential questions being asked there. And if you wait to start your ministry until they're in preschool, you've missed a whole incredible theological moment of trying to make sense of this. And it's particularly if you're in a tradition where you baptize an infant, you don't have a choice in many ways. You have to start ministry with infants, and you start ministry with infants by supporting and being near those who are caring for them as a collective person. So what would he say back to generations? I think Dietrich would walk this edge of always calling older generations and those in power to hear their children, to respond for their children. And I think, and maybe this is just too Germanly formal, he would call young people, and we hate this word in the age of authenticity, but he would call children to be obedient to their elders, to remember that they must find their salvation in this community of people, that it's here that they'll encounter Jesus Christ. So I think he would be very critical. I think if Bonhoeffer would have lived through the 1960s hippie revolution, he would have, Dietrich was a conservative guy that way. He would have found that very peculiar. I mean, you remember that the cost of discipleship or discipleship is a man screaming at you to nefolge, to follow. Follow. I mean, if you read that book, you should, after about 30 pages, go, why is this man yelling at me? Because that's what he's doing. He's yelling at you to follow and to obey. Remember, he says in that book, only the obedient believe, and only those who believe obey. You know, so those are words that have been hard for us in the age of authenticity, to deal with obedience, loyalty, following. But that's, I think, what Dietrich would say to the younger generation. But he would turn back to their parents and say, you better make a space for them. Because these are the ones. These are the ones. This is the eschatological form. So maybe one more and we probably should be done. Yeah, go ahead.
I was thinking of a practical level.
Yeah.
How do we do what Bonhoeffer did with brother-in-law, and then she did the children? I mean, I recommend anyone turn up about this. I'd be unprepared.
Yeah, yeah.
Bring your question.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, and you know, in our current context of correctness,
yeah.
Protection of children,
yeah.
How do we bring in these big topics?
Yeah, yeah.
Considering that a big portion of the youth have already become this kind of church.
Yeah.
And it's kind of bringing them in the next generation.
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, first of all, I mean, when you said we're living in an age of protection of children and things like that, that's why I said when it's 1920, so Dietrich can grab this kid. Like, an adult alone with a 10-year-old in a flat holding them nowadays would be like major red flag here. And so we live in that context, and we have to be aware of that and be wise with that and things like that. So, and then you talk about not being prepared.
So would a pastor with a very young girlfriend.
Yes, I mean, all those things are yes. Well, yes, that's right. We don't need to get into the fact that Dietrich was 39 and was dating a 17-year-old. We won't go there. I mean, yeah, that he actually took through confirmation. So, you know, like I think it's so easy to turn Bonhoeffer into the perfect saint, and he's not that. And he had his issues here, and we can talk about Maria another time. But so what would we do? I mean, to go back to that confirmation story is quite a fascinating one. Because like I said, that the synod wanted him to take it over because there was an older pastor who could not control these boys anymore. And that pastor's name was Johannes Mueller. And Mueller was at least in his 60s, maybe nearing his 70s. And the story goes that when Dietrich went to the first time, that they walked into the building and all the boys were up on the other level looking over the railing. And when they started to walk up the stairs, all the boys started throwing garbage and banana peels down on Pastor Mueller and this strange young man who was walking up with him. They got up to the top, and Mueller pushed all the boys into the room, shut the door, and yelled at the top of the lungs amidst the chaos, "Your new teacher is Herr Dr. Bonhoeffer." And then Mueller, the story goes, the boys started chanting, "Bon, Bon, 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 Bon." I mean, pure chaos. And the story goes that Mueller was like, "I'm out of here," and just left. Like, he didn't stick around and make sure Dietrich was okay. He's like, "I'm finally done with this," and he left. And so this is what happened. And there's this book called I Knew Dietrich Bonhoeffer, which actually has some of these confirmands writing stories about this. So it comes from a good source. That what happened is these boys are chanting, "Bon, Bon, Bon, Bon." And the story goes that Dietrich just kept his composure. And then at about this level, started telling a story about Harlem, just so the boys in the front row could hear it. And then it was like a wave. They were quiet to hear the story, and then they were quiet, and then they were quiet. And then he finished his story about Harlem. And he said to the boys, "If you come back next week, I'll tell you another story." And from that, it transformed the class. And he actually then writes a letter to Erwin Schutz, his Swiss friend, and says, "For the first time ever in my youth ministry experience, I had disciplinary problems. So badly that actually the boys had quite literally aggravated their first teacher to death." And it's true. Poor Pastor Mueller, 2 weeks later, had a heart attack and died. So Dietrich took all the boys to the funeral. And Dietrich was taking over a confirmation class that had killed its first teacher. So what Dietrich did throughout the rest of that, I mean, he's Dietrich Bonhoeffer, like you're saying, so not preparing is probably not a good way to pass on what you should do. But Dietrich did two core practices that I think quite practically we can take away. Is one, he kept his composure. And two, he told stories. And keeping your composure communicates something really significant, I think, to young people particularly. It says, I'm here for you. I'm here for what might happen in this room. I'm not here to get my goals met. I'm not here so I leave here feeling like I'm a great teacher. I'm here actually that we might encounter each other's humanity. So if my goals get upended, I'm going to have to be taken back to your personhood. But same way, you're going to have to see my personhood. And that means you're going to have to recognize me as a person here. And the second thing he did is tell stories which actually revealed his personhood. And I would probably encourage everyone to be prepared. But I think holding up, knowing the tradition deeply so that we're prepared for these moments. But it's really through the articulation of a community of faith stories that faith is passed on. I mean, one of, I think, the abstractions of what I presented to you is what theology is just the trusted stories and traditions of communities of people through time that have held on to it. But it has to be embodied in persons living it. And I think what Dietrich was trying to do was pass on what was significant about this biblical story, what's significant about these creeds and these doctrines through the stories of lived people. How did this African-American community read these texts? What does that mean for us? How do we live that out? So quite practically, I think it is, do we hold enough composure that the young people we meet, it's not our goals that set the terms and therefore can be frustrated, but the anticipation that God might move through our shared humanity here? And then how might we dwell on these stories and these doctrines enough that they become our own story? I mean, I think in many ways that's what Paul is after here. There's a great New Testament scholar named Michael Gorman who really writes about what Paul is trying to do in his own communities is to get people to continue to rehearse through their own lived experience the story of cross and resurrection, and to see all of their lives through the pattern of cross and resurrection. And I think what Bonhoeffer is trying to do is pass on the tradition through creating a community of shared humanity where we did that. So I haven't given you probably enough practicality here, but I think if I was to give you two practices to think about, it would be keeping our composure and learning to tell stories. And I think in my own theological education and what way I'm, the institutions that I'm involved in that are training pastors and youth ministers, we don't give enough space for people to learn how to tell good stories and how to tell even stories that reveal their own humanity, but do so that doesn't become a power play or a gross just revealing of things that one shouldn't share publicly, but actually are a way of kind of emotional intelligence of how you do that. And I think Dietrich had that intuitively in some ways, but I think that's potentially a powerful thing. So more to say probably, but I've gone way too long. And thank you all for being here.
Thank you.